is Valerie Young, who's going to be talking about reproducible builds.
Great. Well, I have some questions for you guys. Does everyone here program to some extent? Does anyone not program? No? Okay.
I'm just a programmer.
Close enough.
I forgot most of what I learned in my computer programming class last semester, which is why I ended up withdrawing from my data structures and algorithms class, because they were the first couple of weeks were like, oh, just follow along.
If you've ever compiled a program, that's what I mean by are you a programmer, maybe, so a little more big than that. Okay, so cool. So I'm talking about reproducible builds, and does anyone know about this project, reproducible builds?
Well, I attended a presentation at Leave the Planet last year.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
I thought you looked familiar. I guess I'm supposed to have seen you. Well, I think I might have meant, unfortunately, tell you anything all that new. Well, maybe something's near the end, but cool. I think Holger gave that talk.
I don't actually remember. Talks tend to blur together because there are so many of them.
Yeah, sure, no problem. Well, refresh it then, I guess. And I think I saw some chase of the head, reproducible builds.
First time I heard about it was on a email.
Oh, great.
I heard it mentioned in Jacob Applebaum's talk a couple of years ago. I wasn't there, but like I watched his talk on like the State of the Onion or something.
Yeah,
he mentioned how the Tor project and whatnot were trying to make it so that, you know, what happened a year and a half ago where the NSA or FBI used a JavaScript exploit to de-anonymize a bunch of people.
Right, trying to protect against that.
Yeah.
Exactly, great, cool. So reproducible builds. A lot of people know security reasons for reproducible builds, but I have this tagline here, what if you could always compile free software? It's not always easy. So I'm Valerie Young. I studied physics and computer science at BU and graduated in 2012, but then instead of doing any physics, I just started programming at Athena Health, and I did that for a couple of years. I actually am only relatively recent user of a Linux-based operating system, 2012. But I've always been, I was an enthusiast since I first learned to program. I was like, whoa, free software sounds so cool. Like, of course we should share information. Anyway, so in 2016, I actually started contributing to Debian because of Outreachy. And Outreachy gets its own Slack because it's super cool. Outreachy is funding for women and minorities to work on free software projects. So it's kind of like Google's Summer of Code. It's 3 months long. You look at a list of mentors and projects, and you contact one of the mentors and like decide on a project, and then you get to work on it for 3 months. It's really cool because it's not limited to programming too. So if there are people who want to do things like documentation or user research or design, also Outreachy has opportunities for that. So just trying to get more people involved in free software in general. And more women involved in free software, which is great. So I encourage you all, if you think that you could do this at your work, to try to fund Outreachy students or be a mentor for an Outreachy student. Or if you know any women or minorities too, like remember to tell them about this opportunity. Most people that I know who did Outreachy were adult women who were like, I want to do something else, and like just switched over. So. Great, so this is an overview of my talk. Reproducible builds, I'll describe what it is. I'm going to talk about its relation to free software freedom, give a history of the reproducible builds effort, and talk about what's left to do. So one, what is reproducible builds? Reproducible builds is kind of a really big umbrella term that encompasses a lot of different technical goals and aspirations to achieve the specific goal of being able to link source code or binaries back to the source code. Because as we know right now, it's a one-dimensional or one-directional function. You take a source code and you compile it into a binary, but then when you get the binary, like how can you ever prove that it came from the source code that we claim it does as free software advocates or as free software authors? You could take that source code and compile it again, but the chance you're going to get the exact same bits, like, very unlikely. So, as it turns out, pretty much impossible until recent work, or simply not done. So in general, reproducible builds kind of has two categories of goals. One is that the compilation of binaries should be deterministic. So your GCC compiler shouldn't arbitrarily add some indeterminacies into your program each time you compile. It should be exactly the same. And also the build environment of the binary should be reproducible. So the build environment of your program would be like the versions of the libraries that you used. So if you take source code and compile it with a different version of a library, it might compile successfully, but it will have a different bit-for-bit result. So then you suddenly don't know if your original binary came from the same source code because you have a different output. So you can't verify your binary came from source code unless you also know all the versions of all the softwares and all of the flags you use in optimization of all of your compilers. So, reproducible builds. Those reproducible builds. So more about it. Onto software freedoms. I'm sure all of you are very familiar with the four software freedoms.
The previous slide you were intending to... I'm just sort of wondering about this one that you just sort of, it's briefly there and then you're just straight past it.
The build environment of the binary should be reproducible? Sorry, I will actually explain both of these in much more detail, how they're executed later on. But the point is that reproducible builds, I think that there's maybe an assumption that it just means deterministic builds, being able to always compile.
I'm curious why you sort of have this one slide there that you seem to skip over it. Are you planning to get rid of that slide in your final presentation for, or what?
I don't. Maybe I didn't go to it.
That one.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. That's what you're asking. Sorry. Thanks for the feedback, but I'm on to the second section of the talk, which is the talking about free software freedoms, which you all know, probably. The freedom to run, and also the freedom to study and change, the freedom to distribute copies, and the freedom to release improvements. I'm actually only going to talk about the first software freedom, which has essentially two parts, the freedom to study how the program works and the freedom to change it to your needs. So what I want to ask is, in the first part of the freedom, do we actually have it? Can we actually study the free software programs that we download onto our computers? As you all know, a program has two parts. It has the source and it has the binary. The binary is what you download and what you run, what you have the freedom to run and to redistribute as it is free software, but it's the source code that you need to utilize your freedom to study the program. And so you can't really execute this freedom necessarily if you don't have reproducible builds, if you can't prove that the source code that you're studying actually produced the binary that you're running. The answer is that we don't have necessarily the freedom to study these programs without faith or bit-for-bit reproducibility. To motivate why we really do need bit-for-bit reproducibility, it's not but I compiled the software and I took a diff and there's only a few bits different. It's probably okay. It's probably from the same source code.
When I worked for Digital, I was in the compiler group.
Yeah.
And that was our requirement. Everything that we built that we shipped had to be built with known libraries and known compiler.
Oh wow, cool! You'd ship it with this knowledge available. So if someone was "Can I have the source code of this?" You'd be like "Sure, here's the."
It wasn't open source.
It wasn't open source.
At the time.
You just knew, right? There's a lot of.
If you could buy the source code, because we sold the source code.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, cool, that's awesome. Well, we forgot about that for a while. So, we're back on the board. But I just wanted to describe this OpenSSH bug from 2002 led to a vulnerability where someone could remotely get root on a computer. And the bug was a less than instead of a less than or equal to. So that resulted in an exactly 1-bit change in the binary that was compiled. That one bug resulted in a 1-bit change. And so if we're talking about making exploitable programs, then 1-bit is enough to exploit a system. So it's important. Also, without reproducible builds, the developer is a single point of failure. Of course, like a developer could be compromised, a developer's laptop could be compromised, and this 1-bit could be switched by a compromised compiler, which probably you guys have heard details of different exploits for compromised compilers. And then suddenly, like, you know, you push an update on a security software and everyone has an exploitable machine. And there's a really good talk that goes into a lot of detail about the different security motivations that I have linked here, and maybe I'll be able to send out afterwards. So the next freedom I want to discuss is AB, the can we change the program? So back to this source binary duality. Here I just wanted to say that there's a lot of times when it's just hard to build the source code. You don't actually know the exact version of the library that you need to make it compile. It's a difficult task for a lot of people, especially a lot of people perhaps with not a lot of technical or system experience. So this is back to one of the original points that I made under the umbrella of reproducible builds. The builds environment should be reproducible, which is what you're talking about, because you want to be able to recompile the code that you created. And I think that like having this reproducible build environment will really lower the barrier to contribution for people who are lazy or simply don't have that much time to figure out how to recompile some free software that they're using. So that's important. And I think that this being able to replicate the build environment always guaranteeing that any free software that you use, you will be able to recompile or maybe extract away the compilation process will make it lower the barrier for non-technical people who could definitely change some pieces of the code. It is written in English, especially for maybe designers or user researchers, could again like perhaps change the code but not go through the whole process of compiling the software. So free software delivers the freedom to study and change. A reproducible build delivers the freedom to study and change your programs. Now I'm going to give you a history of reproducible builds. This is something that people have variously cared about through the years in free software, but in general we don't put that much effort into thinking about making our code reproducible. As I said, like take any random free software project and try to reproduce it, you will find you won't be able to bit for bit. So a few really well-known projects started to revamp reproducibility, and I'm going to describe for them. So how to change 60 years of non-deterministic programming habits, except for a few occasions where we tried already. The first project that's really famous for doing this is Bitcoin in 2002. Bitcoin became really concerned with reproducing their software because there's lots of money in Bitcoin, and so they didn't want a developer to be compromised, of course, because, they wanted to protect their developers from attacks or from scrutiny if someone ended up stealing lots of Bitcoins from a exploit in the Bitcoin core system. So they created Gideon to be able to provably reproduce their code and prove it to the public and prove it to themselves. Gideon is just a wrapper around QEMU Ubuntu virtualization and will just create an environment and build the software in that environment. And in this way they were able to very easily have reproducible builds. This is the way that this helps is it removes a lot of indeterminacies in the build environment. So this is kind of shipping the build environment along with the code. And things like compiler versions or kernel versions or other build machine metadata like host name and time. So then followed Tor, which you mentioned. So Tor also the same year was like, we're doing it, reproducible builds. And why do they care? Well, human lives. There's a lot of governments who would like to know who's using Tor for what. So there's a lot of money in traffic, you can imagine, being used to exploit systems like Tor, so they want to prove that it's safe. So Tor is much more complicated. It's the whole Firefox browser and 50 other packages on top of that. So they also used Gideon to do this, but several months of developing in order to solve all the additional sources of irreproducibility in the actual software that they're using in Tor. And I'll describe a couple of them. So one is Python OSWalk. So this is the functionality that just will give you all of the files in your operating system. It turns out that it'll return the files in a non-deterministic way because it goes through the files based on the inode number, but that depends on when the file was added, and that depends on when the multi-threaded build process finished creating it. So you end up getting random ordering of files, which ends up with indeterminacy in your code, and that ends up being a source of indeterminacy in a lot of places. And also sometimes when you sort the files first, the sorting depends on locale, because the locale will sort based on slightly different alphabets. So sorting is a fun problem. Then GNU tells us another kind of a crazier problem. They found every time they cross-compiled the Windows Firefox, they would have three random bits. And they're like, where are these bits coming from? And eventually just wrote a script in as part of the Gideon build process to stamp out those bits because to produce their deterministic build. But someone noticed that they did that and anonymously actually submitted a bug fix to them and GNU binutils to fix the problem, which was, as you see, it just depended on some uninitialized part of memory. So uninitialized memory is another source of indeterminacy in some programs.
Can I ask some?
Yeah.
It's not a whole virtual machine, but is the virtual machine
That's such a great question. Yeah, we're trying to go back and back and back and trying to get as far as we can in the trust system, but it's true, we don't have a reproducible operating system yet. So it could be that the virtual machine was exploited, but you'd have to exploit every virtual machine, I guess, that is being used in this build process. So it's not like,
I don't supply my own.
Yeah, that's true.
You
can get it from the source.
If you always use a standard distribution to build it, a specific version of that to do the unbuild, then it should always come out the same.
You could potentially get your VM from different sources, I think. So it's still, perhaps you might eventually see like a difference in two outputs. But still, that's like a valid point. I don't think that they ship the Ubuntu image with the kind of instructions for reproducing. But I don't know for sure. Anyway, so I want to also talk about a few things that are kind of like greater problems than this, or problems that Tor didn't solve. One is that this build process actually just takes an incredibly long time, much longer than just compiling Firefox. And then the other thing is, most browsers use actual profile-guided optimizations, which is this proprietary software released by Windows that will take your browser and profile it while it connects to the top 100 websites, and then recompile your browser with that information. So this is non-deterministic by design, right? This is like non-determinism that also depends on websites in the internet, so our websites in the world. So you could imagine there must be vectors of attack there. And again, you can't prove that you have a deterministic operating system in the end, or a deterministic web browser in the end. Okay, so, well, if you thought those problems sounded like maybe a little bit hard, imagine trying to reproduce the Debian operating system. So the Debian operating system has 4,000 packages, about 1,000 main developers, lots of languages, lots of compilers, lots of potential sources of indeterminacy. So how to begin? In 2013, someone had a discussion after They held a discussion after Tor's success and Bitcoin's success and created a wiki page and attempted to reproduce a few packages to get everyone on board. And they were successful, but they also realized a lot of sources of indeterminacy were in the toolchain. So they also patched a bunch of the toolchain, and it turns out this does make a lot of packages in Debian reproducible. But I can't tell you how many packages it necessarily. Actually, well, I think I could look up that information. Maybe I should. Anyway, but in the end of 2014, Debian also started continuously testing every package in Debian, so to surface this reproducibility. So that is to say, Debian's really on board. We're really deep in trying to make Debian reproducible, and we're surfacing this information to all of our developers. And I'm working on this infrastructure. That's what I did for the 3 months that I was funded on it by Outreach. So test.reproducible.builds.org is where you can see the results of all the tests that we do on all of our packages. This is just a graph of time from 2015 to now of reproducible packages. Green is reproducible, orange is not reproducible, red is fails to build from source. Yep. And we're pretty good. We're at 90.
What's the black?
Oh, black is don't build on this architecture for some reasons that I, or other. Yeah. I don't deal with those packages, really. Anyway, so if you go to test.reproducible.builds.org/any-package-name, does anyone here use Debian?
I used to up until I started working on Prime Fedora.
Cool, great.
Well, I got it on my Raspberry Pi.
Nice.
Technically it's Raspbian, but right from the bottom.
Yeah, for sure. Or Ubuntu, yeah. Anyway, so if you go to test.reproducible.builds.org/any-package-name, you'll see the results of this test. So the test is literally just building the package twice and then comparing the output. And we test on three architectures right now. And between the two tests, we vary some information in the build environment. And these are all of the things that we vary. Everything else mostly remains the same. But domain hosting, time zone, file ordering, program ID, etc. Shell even.
Is there any way to verify across those different platforms? So you do an AMD 64 build, and just based on that, then you do an i386 build, and you cross compare. Whether in fact the i386 build that you end up with is consistent with the AMD 64 build, if that makes sense. So not just sequential builds on the same platform.
Right. I think that the binaries between AMD 64 and ARM will always be different for
sure.
Yeah.
And i386 also.
But you mean cross compiling?
I guess I was just wondering if you know, given that you're comfortable that the AMD 64 build is reproducible. Right?
Yeah.
That you've got that platform. And somebody else runs off and they build it, you know, from what they think is the same source on 386, but they're not going to rebuild it on 64. Is there any way to do, or is it just so wildly different? I guess, what are you comparing the reproducibility to? Is it so compared to a master on that platform?
What are we comparing? Well, right now we're just comparing the packages to themselves on the same architecture. I'm not quite sure I totally understand
I think what it means is if it succeeds to be reproducible in one architecture, is it almost always reproducible in the other architectures, or is each architecture independent?
Well, I have seen many cases of packages being reproducible only on one architecture. I could crunch those numbers and find out.
That answers this question.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess, I mean, it's just a simple interpretation of, you know, if you take like a wild hash of an AMD64 binary
mm-hmm.
and compare that to the hash of the same sources run through an i386 build
mm-hmm.
and take the magic hash of that and compare the two and say, yeah, they're both verified.
Right. But the two hashes will be different. So
right.
If you actually wanted to know if a package was reproducible on the architecture you wanted, then you would have to compare to someone else.
So another way to ask the question is that relationship stable? in the sense of it's the hash on the AMD64 relative to the, you know, as a function to the hash on 9386, is that a stable relationship? That if you want, you said a reproducible build on
No, you don't necessarily always have a reproducible build. Yeah, sometimes packages fail to reproduce on some architectures and not others.
Yeah.
But I know because I've seen them, but I could after this query the database,
If you do verify it on one architecture,
mm-hmm.
that at least tells you that nobody stuck some nefarious thing in the binary that you do in comparison.
Yeah, that's true.
So,
That
might not completely
right.
Verify that on a different architecture. That does verify,
it does
verify that source code.
You could have a test for, like, if __ CPU equals something, do something evil,
why
you could make some of the architecture.
You could target something for an architecture that's not very popular.
Yeah.
Although you don't get as much bang for your buck as if you're exploiting the more widely used.
That's true, but maybe you have a very specific thing you want to exploit, mm-hmm.
So I have a question too. There
yes.
are multiple different ARM architectures.
Yeah.
Do you have to test each one?
So right now we're only testing these three. And
Well, I mean, as the instruction set is a little different from one model of computer to another. And I don't know the details. I've just read about this in passing.
Oh, okay. Unfortunately, I don't know anything about that.
First of all, you've got the 32-bit ARM architecture where you have quite a bit of variation. You also have the 64-bit ARM, which is they're trying to standardize right now. And we actually had somebody here talking about all of that.
But, cool. Nice.
Yeah, ARM, because the ARM licensing company in the UK did not enforce things. A lot of different chip manufacturers changed it and implemented it differently. So.
Another possibility, if you use a cross compiler on the system you've already verified is reproducible, you compile the other architectures, and that's a standard part of how that is traditionally done, then you can do the verification that way.
Yeah, yeah, yep.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, all right, so I want to talk about a few other things that you'll see on test.reproduciblebuilds.org/package. You'll see the results of this program called Diffoscope, which just takes a diff between two binaries and makes this kind of like pretty image here. So you can see there's like a difference in versions down here. And Diffoscope is actually a really well built tool now. You can check it out and use it to compare any two binaries, not just Debian binaries. It will unpack tars and it will uncompress like PDFs. It will do quite a bit in order to try to really produce for you a meaningful diff between two files. So I recommend it as a tool for debugging. This is only a tool for debugging if you want to tell if something's reproducible, you just take a hash, obviously. But it's very useful for figuring out what's wrong with the Debian packages. And as a result, or from looking at those diffs, we track the various issues that we see in Debian's packages. So on the same page that I was talking about before for your package, you also see a notes file. And the notes file contains these tagged issues that we have, like there's a timestamp in the zip. Like you can see that by looking at your Diffoscope. So there are a lot of developers who notice, oh, there's a new unreproducible package. They might like tag with what the issue is that they see or the several issues that they see. That's all maintained in a Git repos. I guess I just want to talk about there's kind of like a core group of Debian developers who are really dedicated to the reproducible builds effort, and I want to commend them. They've filed 2,000 bugs with patches to make various packages reproducible, it's cool, but our test infrastructure also surfaces so many fails to build from source bugs. Again, like as a quality assurance thing, testing for reproducibility means that you're testing for failing to build from source. source or whether or not you can build it at all.
And I've said on the difference of web page, as you upload the new binaries to that website,
mm-hmm.
is there a package you can download so you can run it locally?
Oh yeah, yes, there is. Well, you can download in Debian and where else? Fedora, I don't know if someone has packaged it for Fedora. I believe it's possible. I know it's around. Or you can check. I should look that up. So, the next thing that I want to talk about, an issue that's super, super common in builds when trying to take the diff of two builds is the timestamp of the build time. So of the 260 tagged issues that we have, 112 of them are related to recording the time of the build in a binary somewhere. And so these are reasons why people think that they need timestamps for documentation, for even reconstructing the build environment. They're like, I knew it was built this day, so it probably had this library involved in it. Or perhaps they use this timestamp for the randomness of the seed. But essentially, you don't need the timestamp of the build environment, which is what we've found in Debian. And instead, we encourage you use the timestamp from the last date of modification of the source code. And we've defined the standard source date epoch as a build environment variable. And we hope that people will set it to the last date the source was changed, because if you change the source again, of course you're going to get a different binary. And it also gives you a lot more information about when the software was written or when it was last modified than the build timestamp itself, because you can rebuild it whenever. And a lot of people have implemented using source date epoch in their software or in their compilers instead of using just the timestamp of the build, including these softwares. And also even GCC is looking at a patch to use it for the date and time macros.
I want to go back to different scope.
Mm-hmm.
I just did a Google search and I found there's a web page from the Fedora update system says it was pushed to stable about 5 months ago.
Oh.
So that probably means it's going to appear in Fedora 25.
Cool, great, yeah.
Yeah,
let's go with this.
It's in
right
now.
Oh, okay.
Cool, great. Yeah, so source date epoch. I also recommend looking that up if you want to use the build timestamp for any reason in your code.
You have a typo.
Do I? Where?
That's pretty
odd.
Nice. Okay, I'll fix that. Thanks. Also, on test.reproducible.org, we run some other tests of other projects, including OpenWRT, CoreBoot, NetBSD, and FreeBSD. And Arch Linux and Fedora and FDroid are in less consistent state. But we're trying to work with this. Debian has spearheaded this project, but a lot of people have jumped on board, and we are happy to use our test it up to also test their code. We have a lot of computers donated to us from Profit Bricks, which is most of the test results that you see. And if you want more information, reproduciblebuilds.org is kind of like a homepage of lots of information about how to reproduce your code and motivations for reproducing your code. And Lunar is another developer who's spearheaded this in the Debian project, and he wrote a very nice talk, How to Make Your Software Reproducible, and you can find this by just searching those terms online. And it goes through a lot of examples of diffoscope results saying, like, oh, look, this is what we see in this diffoscope result from our history of trying to solve these bugs. Great, so that's where we're at now. We've reproduced a lot, we've proven that 90% of Debian is reproducible. Some projects have also been reproduced also, but what is there next to do besides finish reproducing? Well, reproducible builds is not exactly enough to deliver the promises of, or sorry, reproduced builds is not enough to deliver the promises of reproducible builds necessarily. So Debian is 0% reproducible until any user can reproduce any binary on the Debian system. So the reason why is because even if we've proven that we can reproduce these binaries, then like you still might not know the build environment that this was built in. I mean, you could look on Jenkins on our test setup, but in general, if you just have to get installed your binary, trying to reproduce it exactly is not yet easy. So the way that Debian is solving this is the creation of .buildinfo files. So a .buildinfo file contains a checksum of the source, a checksum of the generated binaries, and also the exact versions of all of the build dependencies. So with this information, you can reconstruct your build environment and reproduce the exact same binary with the source code. But we haven't we're right now in the process of figuring out how to distribute these build info files with their binaries and changing the way Debian package system delivery and uploads work. This is an ongoing process that if you go to Debian Reproducible, Reproducible Debian on OFTC, you see people talking about all the time. So build info file just looks like this. I think some other projects are also copying this format and standard, but I can't think of who they are off the top of my head. Great. So, and back to this original point, buildinfo files are sort of this ideal solution for Debian because we have archives.debian.net that keeps track of every version of every binary that we've released, so you can reconstruct your binary at any time given any buildinfo file. But we still need to create the tools to recreate that build environment. So it's like one of our to-do things. Like once we have these build info files distributed, it would be great if someone could actually just write a command or click a button or whatever and reproduce the build environment, reproduce the binary. And other distros, I don't think that they all have things like archive.debian.net, so they'll have a little bit more trouble with this. And other projects as well. This is not something definitely a more gray area. So delivering the build environment with the binary is kind of a big goal, complex problem. So the point is delivering build environment metadata with software delivers the freedom to modify your software because you you're able to reconstruct it exactly. So you can, and you're guaranteed a situation in which you can recompile your code precisely. So again, I just wanted to go over like once we achieve this goal of being able to ship the build environment with your binaries, then you get guaranteed compilation, so more contributors. Another thing that I want to talk about because I've heard I think is a pretty exciting idea is that perhaps you can more easily regulate code and perhaps very serious code, like code that is in a vote counting system or like code that's in your car, tracking the emissions of the car. Does everyone here know about the BLU emission scandal?
And Audi, apparently.
Oh, yeah? Yeah. So there are these binaries that are running in these cars, and they're supposed to be tracking how much they're polluting to the world, but no one's auditing them. No one knows exactly. And even if they were given if the government decided to audit these programs, they could give some source code that was a lie unless reproducibility is essentially the norm, because you can compile it, but you can't like check it exactly unless someone really goes into the nitty gritty of the binary and does some reverse engineering, which is how they found out about the BLU emission scandal in the first place. So, hopefully we can get that someday. And also easier GPL enforcement too. I've talked to a lawyer who complained about how hard, the GPL enforcement is, oh, you're using this like Linux operating system, can you produce the source? And then they give them the source and they have to compile it and be like, oh, this looks like the right source, I guess you should be the right thing. And then also perhaps like a more long-term preference for free software. If you're guaranteed to always be able to recompile, modify your software, then I think it's a pretty tempting to select it. So reproduce builds is not enough part two. We also have to surface the the verified reproducibility of programs to the developers. Again, like we've proved that we can reproduce a lot of Debian packages, but when you have to get install a Debian package, you don't know that. You have no idea who produced that code. You have no idea if it's the same as the build machine that built the code, or if that binary was uploaded by a developer who had a compromised machine. So, Debian, I feel like this is a related question to, I mean, what you were talking about before. Like, again, like, who are we comparing these checksums to? So who is going to reproduce Debian that we can then compare the Debian builder's results of all their checksums? This is not something we have solved yet. We think maybe we could somehow create like a cross-distribution rebuilding, like Fedora always rebuilds Red Hat and Arch Linux rebuilds Fedora or something like that. And then you have some verification process. There's this, other developers could reproduce your code, but this is not necessarily going to scale very well because there's just tons of packages. So if you depended only on developers reproducing everyone else's code and uploading some checksum, that it was reproducible, it's not going to get far enough, we think.
I think that, you know, going back to my earlier comment, a digital closed source, even though we could sell the source,
yeah,
but we could control everything that goes into build.
Yes, yeah.
In open source, and with the internet today, you've got a much wider distribution.
Right.
And controlling that is much more difficult. So it's a much more difficult problem to solve.
Right. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. We can talk about trying to become reproducible within Debian, but then when you're actually considering like all of the free software of the world, yeah, it's much more complicated.
Yeah. There's a terrible downside to all this, which is, one of the problems with any package you get and try to compile is that inevitably it requires some library that wasn't mentioned, some header file that wasn't mentioned.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're looking for all of that. And this just sort of endorses that behavior on the part of the programmer. So now you can specify exactly.
Oh.
It doesn't have to, the programmer doesn't have to run on any system. We're going to specify all the characteristics the system has to have.
In order to reproduce it.
In order to reproduce,
yeah,
it. Which means we can get as detailed as we like.
Oh, yeah.
And it's the user's fault that they can't reproduce it.
Wow, that's an entertaining point. Well, two things. One, you have multiple build info files for binary. That doesn't necessarily, or for a package. I mean, like, depending on the various, like, oh, I've built this package with this exact set of versions. But you're right, but then you can't actually compare it to someone else who's built that package with that exact set of versions.
It's
so,
built with an obsolete version of something, and so
yeah,
you get it, and you say, oh, gee, do I really want to go back to the obsolete version?
Right.
Typically you would say no. But the other thing is, if you really want to know that you're using a binary that comes from the source you've got,
mm-hmm,
why not just compile it?
Oh, yeah, well, the point is that not everyone who uses computers also programs computers or has time to compile software. But yeah,
I mean, would be able to go to the build info file. And why is that build info file hidden?
Hidden? Oh, dot?
Yes.
Build info? Because probably most people don't care about it.
I think there's really a mitigating factor here. If somebody does something pathologically so that technically it's rebuildable, but it's very difficult to do, nobody can do it, they're going to get a very bad reputation for that when a lot of people are having trouble recompiling.
That's true.
They'll be saying, this is bad behavior. Yeah,
that's true. Well, it's very difficult. You always have to search for
it. Yeah, right. When you're making the effort to make it easily rebuild and someone's deliberately gaming the system, a lot of people are going to have difficulty with that. And then that's going to make it clear that the developer is gaming the system. So they're going to kind of get a reputation because of that.
Right. And also, if we're surfacing always the results of reproducibility, but someone uploaded a package that's too obnoxious to reproduce, then there's going to be no evidence that that package is reproducible, which reflects bad on the programmer. Hopefully, if we make reproducible builds the norm in free software, then it would just reflect poorly to create that software. Why don't they upload their library and rebuild and see if it works, and change the build and profile? But
when you do the 40,000 packages,
yeah,
for each package, you gotta pick a new build environment.
No,
so, how much work is that?
So the build info files in general are things that we do not vary between builds.
Oh, so the developer doesn't get to specify the build info file. Say, I want this obsolete library, that obsolete library, and the other file from 10 years ago.
Right, and Debian specifically, the, I can't think of the name, but essentially the Debian builder, the thing that builds the source code, the binary that you download, that is what constructs the build info file. And they use the all the libraries in that release for building that software. But I guess I was treating your question more like, what if everyone always included build info files in their binary in all free software, not just in Debian? Like, then you might have this problem.
Yeah.
But you're right, in Debian this problem is it's definitely much more.
But I have one last question.
Yeah, sure.
Isn't there a sort of contrary movement to have the link editor randomize the placement of routines in the object file to make things difficult for intruders that need to jump to a particular location?
Oh, I don't actually know this.
What was your question?
There's a movement to have the link editor randomize the location of subroutines in the object file so that intruders that need to jump to a particular location relative to the origin can't depend on something good being there. Typically, it just be something random.
If for the purpose of testing, you turn that on and off, you verify with the current off, and also audit the link editor to make sure there's nothing nefarious going on when you turn it on, then you can.
Well, you get a complex situation there because in compiled code, you have not only the object file produced by the compiler, you have a module produced by the linkage editor, but within that binary, you also have things called relocations. So when the loader loads that program, it's going to relocate everything within that program. So things a lot of times will not load in the same address. It depends in the current environment.
Right.
So, and it's not random. It could be. But, you know, generally what the compiler does, this is kind of where I'm looking for it. So within what the linker is producing is for every, essentially, pointer, there's a relocation tag so that when that binary is loaded, those get resolved. And so you may not know where, let's say, libc resides on any one system, and you've got shareable, all your libraries now in Linux are shareable. You know, it's not, when we go back years ago when they were all archived, but every system now has shared objects. So you can't really say this has to go here. Sometimes it just depends when you load it.
Yeah.
And that's for external libraries. I think what he's talking about is within some segments of code that you're producing. And the relocation you're talking about, though, is actually done at runtime randomly.
Yeah.
The binary is the same.
So,
the binary is going to be verifiable. And if you don't want to have one test version that does not do relocation, and the real version that does do relocation, because if you only verify the test version and not the real version, you've lost all authentication the real version.
Yeah.
So you want to have only one version, but that's okay, because you have the one binary, and then because the relocation is done at runtime, randomly, and it's done differently on different runs.
Yeah.
Because if it were baked into the binary, then you know, then you'd be back in a situation where you know what location to jump to.
How do we surface the verified reproducible data to non-developers? Right. Oh, we talked about this. Right. So then the other thing is this is like uploading and verifying. We want eventually the goal is after the next release of Debian to make it that a requirement that your binary is reproducible before we upload it to the archive. And that's a goal. Next release. We think we'll get there. But the other half of this, of course, is you want when you're downloading these binaries, you want to be alerted of the reproducibility of the software. So, like, can we have questions like this? Like, do you really want to install this unreproducible software? Maybe, or even if we have these build info files and these rebuilders written, then do you want to rebuild this package and confirm the checksums before installing? We could potentially have something like this. And then other questions are like, how many signed checksums do you require to call a package reproducible? Up to you, I don't know. We don't know. And which rebuilders do you trust also? I don't know. We'll find out. I also wanted to talk about the FDroid reproducible process, because FDroid is also trying really hard to be reproducible. And this is a nice graphic that I stole from the same slide that I, presentation that I actually discussed earlier. So here we see this exact same thing. We have developers who submit their source to Git, and they're assigned binaries to FDroid, and FDroid rebuilds the code from Git and verifies the checksum, and if the checksum doesn't pass, then it doesn't get distributed to users. So, great for FDroid. And delivering the verification of reproducibility with binaries will deliver the trust that we have in free software because we can study the source. So we trust free software because we study the source. And hopefully that too means we can trust the binaries.
Actually, in that slide, I would tend to put emphasis on the source, not study.
Oh, okay. Cool. Thanks, guys. Oh, great. Oh, and with this software freedom, what do we get? I've read about this slide. Well, we get assurance against compromise, a single compromised developer. We get assurance against compromised compilers, unless all of the compilers are compromised. And so free software is provably safer and more transparent than proprietary software. And that is the end. Thanks, guys. If you want more information, again, reproducible-builds.org, and the Reproducible Builds channel on OFTC has a lot of really friendly people. If you ever have questions, they know a lot.
There are other projects out there, like continuous integration and stuff like that, which becomes very, very complex. For instance, containers. Will this container run with this other container and things like that? Or will this product, let's say OpenStack, run with KVM or LiveVert or something like that?
Yeah.
And it's all the interoperability stuff.
Yeah.
It gets very, very complex.
Yeah, reproducible, that's my... like our testing for these kinds of things can catch some of this.
Yep.
Question, you mentioned Python, so the runtime, it's essentially not repeatable, right? So like the sort and stuff like that, file access. So how do you differentiate that so that the Python, the language, is reproducible in the sense that when you compile it, you get a binary.
Right.
But actually when you use it, it doesn't produce reproducible execution. So how do you differentiate? Is there another tag or category for that?
For scripts, essentially, or like for something that...
Well, one of the things with Python...
Well, for deterministic language implementations.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah. Well, if you could reproduce Python, then you're pretty sure it's unexploitable. So then anything that you run with Python hopefully is not exploited because you can read the source code of that.
So in this case, Python, does it still have this anomaly with the sort mechanisms that it doesn't always come out the same sequence based on the node?
So, you know, I'm not sure if all of the patches that have gotten upstream or not, and I don't know about that one in particular.
So the question is Python, in your view, a reproducible? Does it pass that test?
So
even without the runtime verification?
We can look at the results of the Python package on Debian, and that will tell you something. But
We were talking about the os.walk package.
Yeah.
People write compilers.
OS.walk. OS is a module.
Results. The same
it's part of Python.
The same source code, you wouldn't be able to verify their programs.
Yeah, I believe that's true. Yeah.
Could you repeat the question?
Okay. People write compilers in Python.
So.
They get object files. If those object files vary, it would show up in their tasks.
So the other question I had is there's a segue into that was, are you familiar with the Go language? The question is, is there some tag for these languages or for these products that says they're reproducible? So I would expect that the Go language produces code
that
effectively is deterministic in the way it executes. That would seem to be a desirable attribute of it. But I guess I never thought about it.
Oh, whether or not the compiler, I guess that's sort of a question too. Is like the compiler, the compiler is just another program. And
right. So
if we're thinking just in the Debian sphere, then is the compiler reproducible is one question, and then is things that it compiles, the programs that it compiles, are those reproducible? Those depend on whether or not the compiler compiles reproducible or reproducibly, which is different than whether or not the actual compiler's binary is
one doesn't guarantee the other.
Yes.
But the other assures the other. Yeah.
One thing I wanted to step back. Bellar was talking about OS.walk.
Yeah.
And threads. OS.walk goes through a tree in your file system and returns directory names and file names. And it can be threaded. Once you're threaded, the order in which things are going to come back are going to change.
Right.
If you force it not to be threaded, it will be deterministic.
Yeah.
But the issue is threading and performance. And you can force it to sort. You tell OS.walk, for instance, the algorithm you want to use. Do you want to go depth first?
Right.
Do you want to go breadth first? That's two of the things with the OS.walk. I don't want to get really too much into specifics in Python. But also in Python, your Python modules, when they are distributed, you get the .py files, which are the source code. You generally get .pyo files. .pyo files are pre-compiled Python.
Actually, it's .pyc.
Let me get into .pyc. But you get .pyo files. Those are specifically pre-compiled. .pyc files you will generate when you import a module, your own module. That will create a .pyc file on the fly. And what the system does is it checks to see if you're running something.py. And if there is a .pyc file that has the correct timestamp or whatever, it's going to use a .pyc file so it doesn't have to go through the timestamp. But the .pyo is a slightly more efficient version of the module. Usually you find that within the Python libraries itself. You're not going to see that in your own code.
Another question along the lines of like these libraries and stuff like this, and the way that you get stuff that all folds together. Are you familiar with vendoring, this concept of vendoring that people seem to be pick it up on, which is, okay, how do I get the specific version of a library? And so kind of like your build info file seems to indicate the, like the module and stuff like that. But again, with the Go language, what it seems to do is it says, okay, when you go to build, pull down all the stuff for that specific version, if I understand it correctly, and essentially store it, package it along with the build, and then ship it off. So then that's referred to, I think, as vendor.
I mean, I guess kind of building in sandboxes and virtual instances is also getting much more common to solve this version problem.
That's what we do in Python. We have in all of our builds, we have what we call something.txt, resources.txt, and what that contains is that's all the products that we want to download using pip, and we can specify the specific versions we want in there, which is exactly what we do, because if somebody changes the Python version on us, it could blow us out of one. And you know, we're doing continuous builds, we're running dozens of builds all during the day. Right? It's continuous. So it gets pretty complicated.
Yeah?
Unix is a funny one because it when it compiles, it loads a version of itself into memory and then dumps the memory image disk to be the program so that it loads faster later.
I didn't catch your question.
Whether or not Emacs is reproducible? I don't feel like that. You said it dumps it to memory?
But
the first compilation of Emacs, I guess, is reproducible.
Yep.
So
it is?
It could be. Let's find out, maybe.
Because it's a thing that list programs sometimes used to do. It's like they create themselves in memory, and then they take the memory image and store it to disk so it wouldn't have to.
Well, that's what we do in Linux for just about any binary. What's going to happen is, let's say that you have a program foo. You compile it foo, and you know,
I don't want to use only the guess one.
And then somebody else runs your program at the same time from the same object. It's going to share that in memory.
Oh, cool.
And so your text and your non-destructive data will be shared.
What extension is that?
Libraries are written like that all of Linux.
On Firefox, the way where you have the tabs on the side as opposed to
on top. What extension? Tabs.
So what you're doing, especially when you're loading a program, what you're doing is you're mapping it into virtual memory anyway.
Yeah, but it's a little more complicated. The reason I still use Firefox.
Yeah.
The
reason I still
get to a certain state and then just say, okay, you're in memory.
The only thing that works with that whole
region,
library
is dump it to disk as an image. And then
websites where you have to log your cable login and it has to
Emacs. Emacs is interesting because even though Emacs itself is a binary, it also interprets. It's Lisp code. So that's really what they're doing is pre-compiling the Lisp, so that any future instance of it doesn't have to be reloaded. So concept of virtual memory.
Is that tab tree or is it actually
called tree dash tabs? Oh yeah, they're great. And if you open a link from another link, you get it's a tree tab, so you can collapse it or expand it. It's great. Tree tabs.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.